Good morning, church family. It's great to see you, and I'm so glad that you're in the house of the Lord with us worshiping today. There are so many visitors I see out in our auditorium, and it's so great to see you here with us. We welcome you to Oak Hill, and we ask that you stick around to let us get to know you a little bit longer. There's something that, a project that's been being worked on the last few weeks here. Tim Hensley has filmed and been editing a new project that's starring some of our own little people here at Oak Hill. They've had a special part in this project, and we want to share that with you at this time, and we think that everyone here will enjoy it and benefit from it. Let's take a look.
I have 569 weekends left. 460, 270, 278. I have 560 weekends left. By the time I'm 12 years old, you'll only have 72 months,
312 weekends,
2190 days,
2190 days
left to help me become the young woman,
to help me become the young man
God wants me to be.
That's not a lot of time.
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 So use it wisely.
So use it wisely.
I need your guidance.
I need your example.
I need you to help me connect
with the life-changing power
of God's Word
on a regular basis.
Take me to Bible class.
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 Day one, God made life when there was none.
Help me to know God
by learning from teachers who love me.
Help me to be transformed.
Wait, what?
Help me to be transformed.
Help me to be transformed
by being with other kids.
By being with other kids
that are being transformed too.
Redeem the time.
Redeem the time.
Redeem the time.
Redeem.
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 Redeem the time.
Redeem the time.
Redeem the time.
Trade it.
Cash it in.
Make the most of it.
Make the most of it.
Use it for something.
Something you truly care about.
Me.
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 Yes, Jesus loves me. Oh, yes. Yes, Jesus loves me. He loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Good morning, everyone. It is so good to see you standing up here, seeing each of you assembled as God's saints to worship God. How do you top that, David? You don't. I'm happy. To make sure I know who I'm talking to here, how many of you have either heard me preach before or this is your first time? Raise your hand. Think about that for a little bit. I want to see if you're awake, all right? That's good. That's good. It's been a long time. It's been a whole year since last year and the couple days that my wife and I had together to enjoy being with family and to ourselves. We just reminisced a lot. And there's been a lot take place over the past year that we've shared together. And this past year brought us together. And I was mentioning a lot of things along this aspect. You know, only a Sunday went by that I was not here to fill the Sunday pulpit, but it felt like a year. It did, because I love what I do, and I love to be here with you. And David did a great job with that introduction. I saw it online later, of course. And he was talking about that chalk. I'm on my third piece already. And no, I'm actually thankful for the eraser that God will use to wipe away all my mistakes and sins. So we're thankful for that too. It's beautiful to see you today. As the church, as the redeemed body of believers, we are eager to share the news, the great news of the gospel, that no matter who you are, no matter where you came from, no matter even what you've done, oh, it's important what you've done, but no matter what even you have done, God wants you redeemed through His Son. He wants you forgiven through His Son's blood, which paid the price for all sin, allowing you to be restored and appropriate salvation and then exalted to a new status as a child of God and an heir of heaven itself. As we are focusing on this first Sunday of the year, plus one is the catchphrase. We took the direction of focusing on the importance of each one of you. And God's love is so great because it's so personal. Anytime that I have a good portion of time to study with a person about the gospel who grew up and didn't have the benefits of what you saw earlier of being exposed to the teachings of Jesus, who doesn't know the God of the Bible and how much He loves him, I take him to the Gospel of Luke. The Gospel of Luke, the Gentile writer who also wrote the events of the early days of the church, the actions that took place in the book of Acts there, he also wrote the Gospel account of Luke. The Gentile writer just can't help but put his personality in the writing that he researched to share, guided by God, of course, to focus on the individual. Have you ever noticed that about the Gospel account of Luke? Different than any of the others. Luke focuses in chapter 5, 7, 8, 9, 10, 15. It was Jairus' only daughter who died, and that was the focus of Jesus' attention. In chapter 7, it was the one woman who was amongst the whole crowd, but the one woman whose faith propelled her to touch Jesus and be healed. It was the one son of the widow at Nain involved in the funeral procession. It was the one son who was severed from the relationship and the blessings of the fellowship of his father, but came back. The number one is at the heart of the gospel account of Luke, and God's love reaches down. The gospel of Luke is written by the man who he feels incredibly privileged that he is able to enjoy the blessings of all of this. God's love reaches down to Samaritans, to the poor, to the outcasts, to the Gentiles. God's love is so great because he focuses on the individual. Leave the 99. They're okay. They're within the fold. But there's one out there who's lost. Go get them. And that person was me. That person was you. And I'm so glad that I learned the gospel. Thank you to my parents who are watching this likely by delay. But thank you to my parents for valuing me, spending the time wisely to teach me the gospel. And to teach me the gospel from the word of God, not the way the mankind preaches it. When they take it, mankind distorts it. They pervert it. They contaminate it. And it's then man's doctrines which won't save me. God's word will save me. I want to know the truth and to hear it taught well. I wonder where my life would be if it weren't for the gospel and me knowing it. You know, without those core principles that are taught in my life, I don't know what I would be. And I want to say that video you saw, very well edited, by the way, perfect, very well done. That video makes me think about my parents and their raising of me. Doesn't it make the same about you? It makes me think personally, and if you know a little bit more about myself, some of you have met my parents. I like to jokingly say I raised them pretty well. I did a good job, and I'm still working on a lot of things. No, I'm just kidding. Seriously, thank you, Mom and Dad, for understanding what your role is and for taking it seriously. Regardless of your background and your rearing, who you are right now is important to adopt God's will from this point forward. We understand that. We have less time than we did. Redeem the time. But I want to thank my parents publicly for letting their raising of me be governed by one particular premise or rule, foundation for working. The most important role of a parent is to teach and to train the children to respect God, His Word, and follow it in all of their paths so that their ways are straight, and to reverently serve Him in love because of His grace and holiness. That's it in a nutshell. Now, parents, you can't do that with just a 20-minute lecture, but a 20-year example and on through life, it's not much time. So thank you, Mom and Dad, for their example. I'm thankful for their faithful example, not the least of which was their consistent importance placed upon the services or the gatherings for Bible classes and worship of the church, where His Word was studied, where His people encouraged and edified one another. The blessings, why would you not want them? It wasn't always convenient, and as a kid, there were some things I'd rather have been doing sometimes, and as an adult, have to watch myself, but I'm obligated, I choose, right? It's a choice. But you know what? It wasn't, while growing up, a Pharisaic rule to laboriously follow begrudgingly, because we saw the importance. We chose because it was important. A lot of people in my generation in this day and time don't think that anything's important because they don't know God. Well, let me tell you, some things are very important because God is important. And perhaps that's the best lesson my parents taught me. That things are important because God is there and He is watching to look at your life through heaven's eyes. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 is a verse. You can reference it now. Open it to it if you want to. We'll mention it later and read it. But it presents a perspective of life that's far different than how some people view their life and their importance. There are two views in life, ultimately. Either you're important or you're not, basically. And either you have a purpose or you don't. Now, this morning's class, we focus on the idea that each person has a purpose. I cannot imagine living my life without understanding the answers from God's Word itself, the answers to those questions that every human being has to answer. Now, the kids that are not taught the truth from God's Word are being taught lies as answers to these questions. Who are we? Where we come from? Where are we going? Why are we here? How should I live? What's my destiny? How you live affects what you really believe about the answers to those questions. And we have two views. This isn't an apologetics lesson, of course. Andrew and I have already introduced that whole topic to you, and we'll deal with details later, perhaps. But either you're here by blind chance. This is a view of the world that explains away God, ignores all the sciences, tries to sound intelligent to present scientific evidence to support that there is no God. They don't study the whole picture, nor do they show all signs. What they want you to believe is that you have reason to do whatever you want. It's appealing. We'll mention that in just a moment too. But there's a view out there that says you're just glorified matter, but you're still, if not by intelligent design, you're a fortunate but worthless accident. Now, a lot of people believe that. There's another view that would change your life entirely. People say, what's the difference? What difference does it make? It makes all the difference. Here's that other view. You know it well. In the beginning, God created. The infinite, spiritual, incorporeal, moral mind that says, I love who I'm about to create. That implies value, doesn't it? That implies purpose. In the beginning, you're either, well, I'll say it this way, the either view that you believe affects how you live and how you value your own life. Back in 1998, there was a movie that was produced called the animated movie, The Prince of Egypt, based on Moses, of course. It's a worthy movie. I have it in my collection. It's fun to watch as well. There are a couple songs along the way. One of the earlier songs in that movie was Through Heaven's Eyes. I made a reference to that. Thank you, Mom and Dad, for teaching me how I'm to view my life through heaven's eyes. Some of the lyrics go like this. A single thread in a tapestry, though its color brightly shines, can never see its purpose in the pattern of the grand design. Another lyric says, does the stone that sets on the very top of a mountain's mighty face think it's more important than the stones that form the base? There are a lot of emotional points in the lesson today. Looking at your life through heaven's eyes, how can you tell what your life is worth, where your value lies? You can never see with your eyes on earth. Look through heaven's eyes. There is a graphic that's going to be shown on the screen. of how I'm supposed to view my life. Life is great. Life is the most important word. Without life, we wouldn't even know love. But we have life. It's valuable. A lot of people don't even think that their life is valuable. How can I look at life through heaven's eyes? The nebula that you see, it has a nickname, God's eye or heaven's eye. You can understand why it is nicknamed that. How can I know God and his view of my life? Very simple. Look at your life through heaven's eyes. Read his word to you to tell you how he views you and what you're here for. How do you view yourself? Maxwell Moss is a man who made great waves in the psychological world because in the book of Psycho-Cybernetics, he discusses what he discovered as a plastic surgeon. He would have successful surgeries, but still these people who came out looking just like what they said before that they wanted to look like, you know, tuck a chin, tuck a nose and all that stuff. They come out, successful surgeries, but 60% of those with successful surgeries, over half, still didn't like the way that they looked. And after years of research and amazing tests, well-defined and documented, he said, people need plastic surgery of the mind, not just the face, not the face. Isn't that amazing how he came to that conclusion? 6 months of telling kids who are good readers in elementary school that they're poor readers and treating them with the same level of education we would give to poor readers, like in the Bluebird group or the Redbird group, you know how it was back in the day, and giving them the attention that they would give given the better readers, but instead they gave the better readers the poor training and told them that they weren't so good. 6 months later, guess what those test results showed? That the poor readers initially performed better than the better readers naturally. People become what we think about. We become what we think about most often. Dale Carnegie would say something like this, and also Mr. Maxwell came up with these wordings and these ideas, but it wasn't new. Anytime you see something new, profound, go back to the Bible. It's there. God inspired that one. Proverbs 23, verse 7. As a man thinks in his heart, so he is. There's a lot of rich profundity there. We are going to be the kind of people that we visualize ourselves to be. And the reason I stress that today as we focus on you as an individual is because that's a spiritual point. Who you think you are. A lot of people in America are making America hurt right now because they don't have God's view of life and their life. People are turning to drugs and people don't think that they're very attractive and they're needing a change and they're joining dangerous groups with harmful ideologies. They think that they have to have a group identity. They don't visualize themselves very well because they don't know who they are through heaven's eyes. So let's look at the Bible for just a brief moment and mention just a few simple points of who we are and what we're here for. Look at this concept. After you use your designed hand to write this point, God made me, I want you to then look at your hands. When we're born in this life, we don't have the cognitive memory probably to remember what it was like to look at these humans and then realize we are one too. Whoa, what's that like? Whoa. We have, look at these hands. What an amazing design to use in this life. The thumb and the index finger, the greatest vice, and to operate in this three-dimensional world. You're either by the view that wants to explain away God here by chance, too much faith for me, or you're here by design. The view I had earlier says that you're basically matter got created by chance, and then it, by luck, just happened to be a fish one day, and ultimately became a chimpanzee, and then now you are here. Folks, if you believe that you're the 10,000th cousin first removed from Bonzo the chimp, you'll probably start acting like family. And a lot of people, you may jokingly say they do, but let me tell you something. If you are nothing more than glorified matter, what purpose do you have? What value do you have? Nothing. Then what's so attractive about that life? You can do anything you want, ignoring the consequences and the better way to live life, but that's another story. The evolutionary debate will go on until the Lord returns. There's a nice little rhyme that I heard. Dear little grub worm, you don't cry. You'll be a June bug by and by, and in a million years or more, you'll be a college sophomore. Now, that's kind of funny. I don't know how you take that. Some people will say that the year 2015 was the year that everybody got offended by everything, right? But that kind of offends me. I'm just joking. Okay, moving on. I believe this view, Genesis 1:27. Let me go back to that main screen, so sorry about the delay. Genesis 1:27, God made you. He made all of life. And while it's logical to look at all forms of life and realize that they would have some similarities, not because of a common ancestor, but because of a holy designer, there is something different about humans. You go to the zoo and enjoy the wonders of God's creation, but you can walk out of there saying, I didn't see any family there. And some of your relatives might act like family. You know, some of them. I'm going to joke about that if you want to. But you can walk out of there saying, I'm different than that. There's a nature of a spiritual element that's there, physically and spiritually. Listen, think about the kids that you saw earlier on the video. Psalm 139, verse 13. Here's another view of life that would change so many things. God knit me or him together in the mother's womb to do things uniquely that you can do by design. God created you. And then let's notice this next point. Part of the gospel is the sin that we've acquired because we've not followed God's way, but part of the loving aspect of the gospel is God's love to send his son. So let's focus on that beautiful aspect. I am bought by a cross. What you were paid for and with and by argues your worth. The price of the cross argues your worth. The Father paid a significant question. Let me ask you a question. What is anything worth? Let's say the blue book value of a car is $2,000 and someone wants to sell it to you for $10,000. For some reason, if it's worth it to you, you will. But it's not worth that because someone's not willing to pay it. If someone is willing to pay $10,000 for a $2,000 car, it was worth it to them. What is something worth? What someone's willing to pay. Here's my question to you. What are you worth? What are you worth? 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18. Let's notice this, beginning in verse 18, and then we'll read verse 19. For you know that it was not with perishable things, silly stuff like, you know, silver and gold, the most important things on the earth, the most valuable substances by which to give an exchange value. No, silver and gold, that's meaningless. You weren't redeemed with perishable things. But, verse 19, you were redeemed with the precious blood of the sinless Lamb of God who was perfect without blemish, the holy sacrifice of God in the flesh. Remember the point that we had in our Bible study class about God loving you? That love prompted this sacrifice willingly. He did it freely. The horrific scene of the cross, when I survey the cross, I'm a squeamish person, but for some reason I can't stare and gaze upon that. And I have so many emotions that go through my mind, but one is the beauty of the love. Because that's what propelled it. That was my cross. 2 Corinthians 5:21 is a good memory verse. God made him who had no sin to be sin for our sakes, so that we can become the righteousness of God in Christ. That's a pretty good payment, isn't it? What something is worth. Let me read to you this little story, or just speak a couple more details. One time in a Sunday evening, I made a reference to this funny little story, and there are some more details now. The man's name is Billy Ring. Billy Ring, who was a South Sea Island explorer, an Englishman. He was very wealthy, so he could travel a lot. And there was one particular island that he loved to go to. He got accustomed to the people and their customs, and they loved him, and he loved them. And it was customary when a daughter was to be given in marriage for the groom to give some kind of dowry payment or gift of exchange out of courtesy to the father, right? And there was no money on this island. It was a form usually of livestock, some kind of gift. In this case, there was one father who had a daughter who wasn't very gifted with physical beauty, but her personality was like gold, right? Personal, beautiful. And the father thought he'd never give this daughter away in marriage. It will never happen. I'll give someone a dowry, you know, to take her, you know, that kind of thing. But beautiful personality. One day, this South Sea Island explorer just started talking to this lady, and they connected so well. They bonded spiritually to say, I like who you are, and I feel great towards you, and responsible, mature love. And as a result, He went to the father and said, "Can I have your daughter's hand in marriage?" Well, he nearly hit the floor. He was doing cartwheels at that time. He was so excited, but he said, "You know, you have a dowry payment. And it's usually in the form of a livestock. In that custom, probably a cow would be given in exchange. That was common. And if a girl was really beautiful, about two cows perhaps." Well, in this particular time, the son-in-law-to-be said, "I am willing to pay or give four cows for your daughter." And you could hear a ka-thunk as the father fainted. And then the next day, some of the word was already spreading. That woman was walking through the streets or through the open area of the island there, just head held high, shoulders back, smiling ear to ear because someone was willing to give for her. And then people were saying, what's she so happy about? Oh, haven't you heard the ladies we'll be talking? Haven't you heard? There goes a four-cow woman. And I love that terminology there. But there she goes. Why? She was a four-cow woman because that's what someone was willing to pay. But notice in the story, the true story, how she was acting and behaving. Someone valued me that much. On the screen, on your outline, I'm a one-cross man. You're a one-cross man or woman. We're one cross people because that's what someone was willing to pay. Remember that as we now focus on something very important. Remember the focus of one. You're the individual. But there are other people in the world. So let's make a brief mention of this, and then the lesson will be yours. Off my shoulders and into your heart, hopefully. We're all equal. Remember that. We're all equal where it matters the most in terms of God. But I love this country, and I love what it can stand for and what it should stand for and what it is, you know, sometimes trying to stand for, the righteousness that still remains. We try hard to focus on equality for all, even the Declaration of Independence there. A wonderful document. I respect it very much. It has a phrase in there, though, "for all men are created equal." I grew up hearing that with the religious influence of my dad and my brother and all the others. But are we all equal in terms of how the world defines equality? You know, words like love and tolerance and equality, the world doesn't define that too well. But what about us? Brace yourself. I'm going to mention something that we don't have as much time to explore as I would like. But we're not born equal. Hold on. Let me think about it for a minute. That knee-jerk reaction, thanks for holding your knees down. Some of us are born with genetics to be 7 foot tall. Some of us are born to be maybe 5 foot tall. Some of us are born to be great athletes, and we have that capacity to temper it and to hone it. And some people can't, we jokingly say, can't walk and chew gum at the same time, you know? What about physically? No, we're not all equal. What about mentally? Do we all have the same mental capacities and propensities to do the same things? No. What about financially? Some people are born with silver spoons in their mouth and they make bad choices and they waste it all. Some people are born in poverty and then they work their way up. And if we don't define equality, we might think we earn and deserve just as much as anybody else because we are alive and we don't want to work for it. That's another idea that is influenced by the scriptures as well if we're not careful, or not influenced by the scriptures if we're not careful. So bottom line, we're not equal. But the scriptures have something important here. Galatians chapter 6 wisely tells us, don't compare yourself. Don't compare yourself to people with talents that are different than yours. Otherwise, you might feel like you're better than them or that you're not as good. Remember the 1 Corinthians 12 principle about the body? Each part has its own function. Do your part and know that as long as I'm a part of the body, that's what counts. One area in which we are all equal and that it matters the most is in terms of God. When we come to Christ, Galatians 3:26, you are all, and I love that word all, sons of God through Christ. How would the world be if they had this view instead of the divisive views that they have today? For you're all sons of God. For all who were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There's neither Jew, Greek, bond, nor free. Think about the different ethnicities that we have. Doesn't matter if you're in Christ. Wow. For you're all one. Verse 29 here says you are heirs. an heir inherits something, doesn't he? If I'm a child of God, I inherit the things of God. God is of heaven. I'll inherit heaven. As you think about these points today, as an individual, let God fill you, let God complete you, but let's summarize this briefly. God made us, He highly values us, and He paid an incredible price to redeem us. How much then do you value God? How much do you value God? The questions on your screen go like this. Do you value Him enough to live for Him who died for you? Remember the purpose in our class that He came to die for? I hope that you've been inspired to do that very thing. As an individual and as one body here at Oak Hill, one congregation of the one body of those who follow the Lord's will, how do I appropriate, Michael, all of these blessings, namely salvation, forgiveness of my soul, taking care of the only thing that takes care of my sin? The question is, will you be the one who is reborn today because of the view that you now have, taking that view and sharing it with one other person who doesn't know it yet? How do I obey the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection? I reenact it. I also then participate in His death by faith when I'm immersed in the waters of baptism to contact the power of God to wash away my sin and give me new life, the life He came to die for. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ, I've put on Christ. That's the new life we're talking about, the most important one. If you are subject to the Lord's invitation and you realize you want an enhancement of life, you want forgiveness, and if you need to put on Christ in baptism, by all means, let's make it right as we stand and as we sing.